We still lift up our hands. We stand and lift up our hands. For the joy of the Lord is our strength. We bow down and worship Him now. How great, how awesome is He.
Peace.
are the days of Ezekiel, the dry bones becoming as flesh. And these are the days of your servant David, rebuilding a temple of praise. These are the days of the harvest, the fields are as white in the world, and we are the laborers in your vineyard, declaring the word of the Lord.
Put your hands together.
Behold, he comes, riding on the clouds, shining like the sun. At the trumpet call, lift your voice, is near of jubilee. There is no God like Jehovah. 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 Oh, hallelujah, hallelujah.
May you be exalted in this place. For you alone have the power to save. Lord, we want to lift you up for the whole world to see. We cry out to you, God. Father of life, seated on the throne of grace, it's only by your mercy we are saved. Lord, you have said, if we call upon your name, we and our families will be saved. So we cry at your name, El Shaddai, God of grace.
Pray, draw us close to you, God.
draw me close to you. Never let me go. I lay it all down again to hear you say, to hear you say that I'm your friend. You're mine. You are my desire. No one else will do. No one else will do. There's nothing else. There's nothing else could take your place. To feel the warmth of your embrace. To feel the warmth of your embrace. Help me find the way. Help me find the way. Bring me back. Bring me back to you. Lord, that we can turn to you. because we have everything that we need in you. Lord, I pray this morning that you'll minister to all those who are hurting in spirit and in body. Lord, I pray for all those who are dealing with sickness. Lord, I pray that you'll touch them this morning. Lord, that you'll strengthen them, heal them even more. Lord, I pray for your blessing and your hand to be upon each one of us, oh God. Lord, as a congregation, we continue to pray for revival to come. Lord, we continue to pray that you'll draw men to yourself. Lord, we continue to pray for boldness and for your Holy Spirit, Lord, that we can boldly proclaim your word. We worship you, Lord. Lord, you are truly all that we need. In your name we pray. Amen. You may be seated. Before we take up our offering, we're going to invite a member of our missions team to come down and pray for our missionary, and I think that's Laura.
Thank you. Good morning. We have a lot to be thankful for this morning, don't we? We do. We have a great and mighty God, and he's been proving himself faithful even among the Baka. We've been ministering to them for 20 years, and just last week, as is highlighted in our bulletin, we were able to praise the Lord with the baptism of 21 believers. Hallelujah. God is good. God is faithful. And this morning I have several items of prayer and praise for us to lift up to him. Heard from Rita yesterday and she gave me some updates. So if you would bow your heads with me, we will pray. Our God and our Father, we are very grateful for the work that you are doing among the Baka. Thank you for the perseverance of the team that are there. Barry and Desma Abbott, Nathan and Laurel Conrad, Rita Anderton, and many, many others, Father. Thank you for the fruit that they are now seeing come to harvest, Father, in your time. These 21 believers who were baptized last week, we now lift up to you, Father, that they would grow in the grace and knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ. Pray for their solid growth, Father, so that they would adopt a vision for their own people to reach out to the outlying tribal groups amongst them and desire to see them come to you as their Lord and Savior as well. Father, we also pray for the legal paperwork of Jennifer Jesse, that she would be able to gain the guardianship of the Baca baby that was abandoned into her care. Lord, she's been promised for 3 months that next month you'll get it. Father, we ask that you would intervene and that you would work on her behalf to bring that paperwork about so that she can continue on with her home assignment plans. And Lord, especially because this affects the Andertons' return to the field. So we know that your timing is perfect, as you have proven, and we ask that your will would be done here. Father, we praise you and praise you along with Rita for the blessing of the union of her son, Nathaniel, to his wife, Catherine, yesterday. Father, we pray for them as they begin their new life together, that you would draw them close to you as they become one and serve you together. We also pray, Father, for the resolution of the dispute between the extended landlord's family, Father, in solving the cost of the rent and the land situation, Father. It's been ongoing for way too long, and we ask that you would also work on their behalf to bring that resolution about. Father, you have been so faithful to work among the Baka. We are seeing it now, and we have seen it before, and we're just praising you for answering our prayers. May we continue to be faithful to lift up the team and the Baka people, knowing that you love each and every one of them and desire to see all come to know you and grow in you. We count it a privilege to join hands with them in prayer and praise. We ask all these things in your glorious name and for your sake. Amen.
Thank you, Lord. We do praise God for what he's doing in the Baka people. I think most of you know, but for over 20 years, the team has been working there in Cameroon. And after 20 plus years, they're just now beginning to see people come to the Lord. And it really is truly an exciting thing to hear about 22 people at one time getting baptized there, believing in the Lord for salvation, and seeing them go to their own people to preach the message of salvation. Just can't state how exciting that really should be to us. Amen. We're going to take up our tithes and our offerings now. And Carol, could I just ask you to open that box for me? Thank you. And as we do each week, we're going to invite our children to come up. Both groups are going down this morning for a ministry. So kids, if you'll come on up, and we're going to pray a prayer of blessing over them. And as we release them, we'll sing a song and invite you to bring your tithes and offerings to the Lord. Oh, we're so excited over some dollars, I think. Girls, if we could, if I could get your attention for a moment, we're going to pray. Just stretch out your hand with me toward these children. Heavenly Father, once again, we come before you, Lord, as we do each week. We ask you to bless these children. Lord, this is the future of the kingdom of God. This is future ministers and preachers and apostles and prophets and teachers, Lord. Lord, we pray that your word will take deep root in their heart, Lord, that they will grow up strong in you, Lord, each and every one. Lord, may each and every one of them walk in your ways all the days of their life, never knowing the sadness that sin brings into our lives, Lord. Lord, we ask that you bless our tithes and offerings as we bring them to you. Lord, we pray for wisdom as to how best to use them for your kingdom. In your holy, precious name we pray all of these things. Amen. Amen. Children, you may go. Once again, we invite you to bring your tithes and offerings to you. Oh, it goes right. Put off thy slumber, and the truth shall set you free. For out of Zion comes thy deliverer in the year of Jubilee. Oh, wake, O Israel, put off thy slumber, and the truth shall set you free. For out of Zion comes thy deliverer in the year of Jubilee. Oh, hallelujah! Oh, hallelujah! Hallelujah! Praise the Lord! Put off thy slumber, and the truth shall set you free. For out of Zion comes thy deliverer in the year of Jubilee. Oh, hallelujah! Oh, hallelujah! Hallelujah! Praise the Lord! Oh, hallelujah! Oh, hallelujah! Hallelujah, praise the Lord. Oh, hallelujah. Oh, hallelujah. Hallelujah, praise the Lord. Oh, hallelujah. Oh, hallelujah. Hallelujah, praise the Lord. We worship you, Lord. I just want to take a moment just before I begin my message this morning. As we heard last week, Elena's father, she said, had been real sick last week, and she just told me that he passed away. So let's just take a moment and pray for Elena's family. Pray that the peace of God will be on them. Heavenly Father, we just pray that you'll send your spirit of comfort and of peace to be upon Elena and her family. Lord, it is so hard to deal with the death of a loved one. Lord, but I just pray, Lord, that you will just minister to them in this hour, Lord. May your saints minister to them in this hour. Lord, and I pray especially that your word would be preached, Lord, in this hour, that men would know that there is salvation in you and that death is not the end, but life can be found in you. But Lord, we remember Elena and her family, God, and we just pray once again, Lord, that your spirit of comfort and peace would be upon them in this time of tragedy. In your name we pray. Amen. If you would, take your Bibles and turn with me to Isaiah 9. So we begin this morning. I want to just give a quick review of last week. We taught you that little song. It's an old song, Awake, O Israel. And I told you that was a New Year's song. And last week I talked about New Year's just as a way of review for those of you who were here and to bring everybody up to speed that wasn't here. I talked about the biblical New Year, which takes place typically in September. The central themes to Yom Teruah, or the Feast of Trumpets, or Rosh Hashanah, the biblical New Year, is one of repentance, of sounding of an alarm, of waking up to your spiritual condition. And all this is because the day of the Lord, the day of judgment, is near. We looked at Joel chapter 2, which talked about blow the trumpet in Zion, sound the shofar in Zion, sound the alarm on my holy mountain. Joel talks about let the nations tremble, because the day of the Lord is near. And so those were our themes surrounding New Year's. It's our theme for the year. Our key verse, I called it, this thought of sounding the alarm, of proclaiming the gospel, proclaiming the good news, proclaiming that the return of the Lord is near, and when he comes, he will administer justice to all. This morning, I want to ask the question, or pose the question, what if there was an ancient connection between Israel and America that could predict the future of America? What if there were events in the Bible that took place in Israel thousands of years ago and yet are being repeated right before our very eyes? What, again, if the future, if we saw these things taking place, what if we could change the future of America? What if we could change the outcome of what has already been determined because of what we see in God's Word and we see taking place in our nation? Sounds like the plot to a really good movie, doesn't it? Sounds like something Steven Spielberg would put together. Except this very thing is happening right before our eyes. America and Israel share common beginnings and purpose like no other nation in history. We share connections here in America with Israel that no other nation has ever shared. Both were established with common purposes before they became nations. Both were established to be a light to the world, to be a covenant people with God. Both were divided north and south. Both the first king of Israel and the first president of the United States were a head taller than any normal man. Each had 13 divisions when the nation was established, and each took their land from another group of people. Both the Israelites and the settlers of the United States had to journey across water and had difficult journeys to the new land. But is the end of America and Israel tied together just as our beginnings were? Are the same judgments that fell upon Israel now falling upon America? Can we learn from Israel's mistakes and avoid the judgment of God? Is there hope for America today? What I'm going to share with you today is probably the most important message. No, I'm going to say it's not probably. It is the most important message you will ever hear regarding the future of our nation. It is a revelation of God's call to repentance and God's coming judgment like none other I have ever received. It's not a revelation that was given to me directly, but it is something that I became aware of several months ago and began to research, to verify. God has revealed this thing to other very godly men. Please, I implore you, pay careful attention to what I share with you today. Again, if you would, look it with me in Isaiah 9, beginning with verse 8. The Lord has sent a word against Jacob, and it will fall on Israel. And all the people will know, Ephraim and the inhabitants of Samaria,
who say in pride and in arrogance of heart, the bricks have fallen, but we will build with dressed, or some translations say, hewn stones. The sycamores have been cut down, but we will put cedars in their place. We find the nation of Israel here in Isaiah 9 in a state of great sin. She has forgotten and forsook the Ten Commandments, removed them from the consciousness of the people, and is in a state of rebellion against God. The Lord God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob has been removed from public life, and false gods of every kind have arisen to take his place. The people are sacrificing their children to the evil god Molech, and sexual sin abounds throughout the land. The leaders of Israel lie and mislead the people. False prophets are everywhere, and the true prophets of God are despised at best, and more often than not, killed. In response to this great sin that has entered the land, the Lord says, I'm going to send a word against Jacob, Israel. He removes his hedge of protection, which covered the land of Israel, and the Assyrians make a quick and vicious attack on the land. They come in and they break through the defenses, they break through the wall, and they attack in a devastating attack, and then quickly withdraw. And this devastating attack brings terror to the Israelites, even though it's something that happens very quickly. The leaders from the capital of the northern kingdom respond in this manner that we read, and it says, in arrogance of their hearts, the bricks have fallen, but we will rebuild with dressed stone. The sycamores have been cut down, but we will put cedars in their place. So Israel replaces the bricks with stone. The sycamores that were cut down in the attack are replaced with cedars. And they are defiant in the face of the attack. The attack, this was the word that God said he was going to send against Israel. It was a warning to them. He said, the word that I'm going to send is this attack. I'm going to allow the Assyrians to come in so that you will know that my judgment is near. So I begin this morning with a riddle. What comes after and yet before Isaiah 9:10? It's not very difficult. 9-11. 9-10 is followed by 9-11. But how does 9-11 also come before 9-10? 9-11, such a significant event. And I've talked about it time and time again here from the pulpit. And it is something that just seems to always stick in my mind. And I haven't really been able to understand why I thought that was such an important event, beyond what was lost, beyond the lives that were taken. Until a few months ago, I really began to get a sense of what 9-11 was really all about. What I'm going to try to do today is to show how the events of the past 10 years have been a warning from God, and how the events here in modern-day America have followed with extreme precision the events that took place in Israel over 2,500 years ago. I want to take you back in time to September 11th, not 2001, but 1999. Jonathan Kahn, one of the chief men that God has been revealing what I'm going to share with you today to. Some of you may recognize the name Jonathan Kahn. Jonathan Kahn is William Levi's pastor, who we've partnered with in southern Sudan and northern Uganda for a number of years now. Jonathan Kahn, with other Christians, were standing in New York Harbor, September 11, 1999. And as they stood there on what was Yom Teruah, the Feast of Trumpets, they blew the shofar at Lower Manhattan, looking directly at the World Trade Center and what would become Ground Zero. This is, of course, 2 years before the attacks of 9/11, 2001. The shofar, the warning call of God, was sounding 2 years in advance. But was anybody listening? Of course, exactly 2 years later, on the anniversary of the sounding of the shofar, the hedge of God's protection on America is removed. And I think it's safe to say the walls came down. Not physical walls of protection, but the wall of defense our nation has enjoyed for so long, that protection of God's hand upon us is breached. The terrorists are allowed to invade, and they take down the towers. They strike the Pentagon, and yet they're restrained from doing further damage. The wall is breached, the attack comes, but it's over and done with in a day. Many ask where God was on that day. How could he allow the terrorists to succeed? How could he allow the attacks to take place? But the reality is, we drove the Lord out. We did not want him in our schools any longer. Like Israel of old, we removed his commandments from public life. We no longer govern our laws and our affairs by his word. We didn't desire for him to be around any longer. Yet, so many had the audacity to ask, where was God? But if the protector is driven out, how can he protect? If we no longer live under the shadow of his mighty arm, how can we expect there to be any covering of protection for us? So literally, God, in September 11, 2001, is sounding not the first, but the second blast of the warning trumpet. He's trying to wake the nation up to their sinful condition. But once again, was anybody listening? We have removed the Ten Commandments from public display in the courthouses that they were built on. Merely 10 years after removing prayer from public school, we began to sacrifice our children on the modern day altars of Molech and abortion. They've attempted to remove Christ from Christmas, and we've replaced him with the happy holidays. Homosexuality, pornography, sexual sin of all types run rampant, not only in the nation, but in the church. And all the while, our leaders lie and mislead us, and we just love to hear the sound of false prophets. We have systematically removed God from American life, and we wonder why things are so bad here now. I've heard it said that America is following the same path that led Rome to destruction. She is not. She's following the path that took Israel to captivity and ruin. And the removal of God's hedge of protection is no little thing. We read of how the nation that honors and obeys the word of the Lord will receive supernatural military aid in battle. Deuteronomy 28:7 says, "The Lord will cause your enemies who rise up against you to be defeated before you. They shall come against you one way and flee before you seven ways." We also understand in this same chapter from Deuteronomy that the nation that dishonors the Lord, dishonors his word, and disobeys his commandments will be defeated in battle severely. Like Israel, we have been blessed because of our obedience to the Lord. But sadly, on September 11, 2001, everything changed. Like Israel, the walls of the nation are breached, and the enemy comes in and attacks. And this brings a great terror on the people. It was the nation of Assyria that attacked Israel that we read of in Isaiah 9. Now we find a very interesting parallel here. Remember I said, I hope to show you how these things are happening in our nation that happened in Israel with extreme precision. The people that attacked Israel were known for being able to incite absolute terror in the land. The Assyrians were perhaps the most brutal people history has ever known. They were famous for filleting their victims alive, of peeling the skin off of their bodies while they were alive. They would take the heads of those that they had killed in attacks and build pyramids of them. They would throw bodies of their victims over the walls. Perhaps most gruesome and most frightening of all, they would take their victims and they would impale them on a sharp stick while they were still alive and line the roadways with their dying and dead and rotting bodies. When the Assyrians came to attack, it incited terror on the people. They were the terrorists of their day and some of the worst in all of history. Now, the Assyrians spoke an ancient language which is no longer spoken today, but its descendant is the modern-day tongue of Arabic, the language of the 9/11 terrorists. In response to the attacks, Israel is drawn into all sorts of wars and conflicts for years to come after the wall of protection is breached in 732 BC. We too, in the days following 9/11, are drawn into war and conflict. Now, how many of you would agree it only makes sense that when a nation is attacked, you would go after the ones who attacked you? I mean, that makes sense. I mean, it's just a natural reaction that when somebody comes and attacks your land, you send the army after them. And so we did. We went after the ones who were responsible. We went into Afghanistan. But then we find ourselves suddenly and before long involved in another conflict, another war in Iraq. Now, Iraq, really, we find out, didn't have anything to do with the 9/11 attacks. I've said and I've taught that we do not understand the reasons for why we went into Iraq. And I know there's no shortage on conspiracy theories on all of this. Some blame it all on George Bush. Others on oil, some on money and bad intelligence. But I want to say this again. We don't have any clue as to why we went to Iraq. But God drew us there. In one portion of Scripture, it talks about him putting hooks in the mouth of an individual and drawing them into conflict. That's what he did with us. And so why? Why Iraq? Why after 9/11 will we go into Iraq? Does anybody know what part of the world the Assyrian Empire came from?
Iraq.
Iraq, the people there are the modern day descendants of the Assyrian Empire. And so we find ourselves in conflict not only with the ones who speak the modern day equivalent of the language of the Assyrians, but now we find ourselves in conflict with the people who are the descendants of the Assyrians. But what was the response of the leaders? The Lord calls us with the shofar. We say in pride and in arrogance of heart. He removes the hedge of protection. He allows the enemy to come in. Now, God doesn't do anything evil. How many of you know that? Everything that comes from God is good. Evil men murdered American citizens on 9/11. God does not delight in calamity, in murder, and suffering. But he allows these things to happen, to wake us up, to call us back to him. But again, what is our response? What is the response of our nation? Do we humble ourselves and turn to God? Well, there was a momentary resurgence of spirituality, we might say. Churches across the nation were filled. God bless America is heard from the Capitol steps. But there's no real change in the spiritual condition of the nation. And things very, very quickly go back to just as they were before 9/11. And so the nation begins, just like Israel over 2,500 years ago, to move in a response and in a spirit of defiance to the attacks, to the word of God that he sent on us. The bricks have fallen, but we will rebuild with dressed stones. We will rebuild with hewn stones. Israel says, we will not be humbled, but rather we will rebuild bigger and stronger. Instead of bricks that the Assyrians knocked down, we're going to rebuild with stone. Again, it's an act of defiance against the word the Lord sent against them. We read the ancient Greek translation of the book of Isaiah and what is known as the Septuagint. We find additional information as to what the intention of Israel was at this time. It says in the Septuagint, we will build for ourselves a tower. So we understand again that their intention was to rebuild stronger, taller, better than before. Not only did we rebuild, become a huge phrase surrounding 9/11, but as we shall see, everything from buildings to the military was to be rebuilt stronger and better than before. Back to 9/11 2001 for a moment. The buildings came down, and while much of it was glass and steel and sheetrock, the streets of New York were, interestingly enough, lined with bricks. The bricks are noted over and over and over again in press coverage and in pictures. Associated Press writer Richard Pyle described the scene in the aftermath of 9/11. He said, for 3 months, the 16-acre site had the look of post-World War II Berlin, with its buildings skeletonized and reduced to piles of bricks. What was our response to the collapse of the towers? We will build for ourselves a tower. We'll build the Freedom Tower, which will be bigger and better than anything that ever stood before it. Governor George E. Pataki's remarks on July 4th, 2004. He said, let this great Freedom Tower show the world that what our enemies sought to destroy, our democracy, our freedom, our way of life, stands taller than ever. Governor James E. McGreevy, borrowing from the Old Testament book of Haggai, said this, the glory of this latter house shall exceed the former. I ask you, what is the most important part of any building? It is its cornerstone. It is the stone that everything else is set upon and built upon. What was it that Isaiah 9:10 said? We will rebuild with hewn stone. Hewn stone is a stone that is quarried out of the mountainside. Again, the Israelites did this a way of showing their defiance by replacing the bricks that had fallen with something stronger and greater than what was taken away from them in the attacks. A stone hewn from the Adirondack Mountains was commissioned by the builders of the Freedom Tower and was dubbed the Freedom Stone. When it was put into place, the governor of New York said, "Today is indeed a monumentous day. Today we take 20 tons of Adirondack granite, the bedrock of our state, and place it as the foundation, the bedrock of a new symbol of American strength and confidence. Today we lay the cornerstone for a new symbol of this city and this country and of our resolve in the face of terror. Today we build the Freedom Tower." And later on, now listen to his words here. He said this, today, we, the heirs of that revolutionary spirit of defiance. The heirs of the spirit of defiance. That is what he called us. As if that's something to be proud of. The symbol of American strength and confidence. The cornerstone of America is not a stone that has been cut out of a mountain with hands, but rather it is the cornerstone, Amen. Jesus Christ the Lord. Amen. But there's still more. The sycamores have been cut down. When the North Tower collapsed at 10:28 a.m. on September 11, 2001, a steel beam flew through the air towards St. Paul's Cathedral, which stood just a few hundred scant feet from ground zero. The cathedral is one of the oldest in America. It's one of the most important cathedrals in the United States. And it would have been destroyed or badly damaged if it was not for a sycamore tree that stood next to the church. When this beam came flying out of the collapsing North Tower, instead of hitting St. Paul's Cathedral, it struck and uprooted the sycamore tree that had stood there for over 100 years. The uprooting of a tree, or the chopping down of a tree, signals the uprooting of a nation, of a kingdom, or a king in Scripture. The Lord said in Jeremiah 45:4, "Behold, what I have built, I am breaking down, and what I have planted, I am plucking up." America and Israel were built on the Word of God. They both prospered because of the Lord, and the Lord blessed both with great power, military might, and wealth. He tore down what he had built in Israel and uprooted her, as symbolized by the uprooted sycamore tree. And here at St. Paul's Cathedral, a place of great historical significance for our nation, the Lord uproots the sycamore, the sign of the uprooting of a kingdom. And what is our response to this ancient symbol of the removal of a kingdom? We will put cedars in the place of the sycamore. Now, it would seem logical that if you lost a significant sycamore tree, you would replace it with what? A sycamore tree. But just as recorded in Isaiah with Israel, America replaced her sycamore tree with a 21-foot Norway spruce, which is the North American equivalent of the Middle Eastern cedar tree. The cedar is called the Tree of Hope. It was planted in the northwest corner of the churchyard at St. Paul's Chapel on November 22, 2003, replacing the fallen sycamore tree. St. Paul's went on to conduct a prayer meeting and a ceremonial lighting of the tree to offer hope to this nation. How many of you believe there is no hope in a cedar tree?
Amen.
There is hope in the tree that Christ hung on.
Amen.
And that is our only hope and the only hope for this nation. But instead of turning to the one in whom we know there is hope, salvation, and restoration, we turn to a cedar tree, which is the symbol of a nation defiant to its Lord and to its Creator. How many of you think this is pretty amazing stuff? But we have the vow of defiance. If the pattern is to be completed, if all the things that took place in Israel have to take place in America to know this is from God, then the leaders of the people have to make a vow of defiance like Israel did. And also in the capital. Samaria was the capital of the northern kingdom of Israel. And where the leaders of Israel made their vow of defiance, Ephraim and in the inhabitants of Samaria who say in pride and arrogance of heart, "The bricks have fallen, but we will rebuild with dressed stone. The sycamores have been cut down, but we will put cedars in their place." Though it wasn't always the capital, Washington, D.C. is the current capital of the United States. Washington and New York were already linked together, tied together in the attacks, because it was not only the Twin Towers that were taken down, but the Pentagon that was hit as well. And so the two are already tied together. Just one day after September 11th, 2001, we find this pattern being taken a step further. For on September 12th, 2001, Senate Majority Leader Tom Daschle, speaking on behalf of the people, he's speaking on behalf of the Senate and the House of Representatives, the one who represents us. And he says from the Capitol, "Mr. President, It is with pain, sorrow, anger, and resolve that I stand before this Senate, a symbol for 212 years of the strength of our democracy, and say that America will emerge from this tragedy as we have emerged from all adversity, united and strong. The world should know that the members of both parties and both houses stand united. The full resources of our government will be brought to bear in aiding the search and rescue and in hunting down those responsible and those who may have aided or harbored them. Nothing can replace the losses that have been suffered. I know there is only the smallest measure of inspiration that can be taken from this devastation. But there is a passage in the Bible from Isaiah that I think speaks to all of us at a time such as this. The bricks have fallen down, but we will rebuild with dressed stone. The sycamores have been felled, but we will replace them with cedars. This is what we will do. We will rebuild and we will recover. That wasn't enough. The vow of defiance appears again, this time on September 11, 2004. The Democratic candidate for Vice President John Edwards spoke at a prayer breakfast for the Congressional Black Caucus, saying, "Today, on this day of remembrance and mourning, we have the Lord's word to get us through. The bricks have fallen, but we will rebuild with dressed stone. The sycamores have been cut down, but we will put cedars in their place." And let me show you how we are rebuilding and putting cedars in those three hollow places, the footprints of the towers, the Pentagon, and the field in Pennsylvania. Walk with me through this day, and you will see that this is a season of hope. Walk with me through this day, and you will see that while those bricks fell down and the sycamores cut down, our people are making those cedars rise. Not only does he pronounce judgment on the nation like Tom Daschle did before him, not only does he once again give this vow of defiance against the word that God is sending upon the land, but he changes the tense from the future to the present and says, we are doing this thing. He not only gives the vow of defiance again, but shows that the vow is in effect and being carried out. The leaders of our nation, the ones who represent us, presented the text as if it were a passage of hope and encouragement for the nation, when it really is speaking of a nation's condemnation, by conveying the proud, arrogant, and unrepentant state of the heart of the nation. Out of over 30,000 verses of Scripture, think about that for a moment. Out of 30,000 verses of Scripture, the one that both of these men choose is a scripture of judgment. And they link it to 9/11, saying, it was the Lord's word to us. Israel was eventually overrun by the Assyrian Empire, carried away as slaves to serve the king of Babylon some 30 years later. And this was because of their defiance to the Lord, because of their unrepentant state. The temple was destroyed, and many, many Israelites suffered, died in those attacks. God is sounding the shofar to our nation. He is calling us back to Him. He is calling us back to the Ten Commandments and the word that this nation was founded upon. But the question is anybody listening? Question is there hope for the United States of America? I, for one, love the United States of America.
Amen.
I don't want to see our nation, my friends, my children, go off in the captivity. I don't want to see our nation attacked again. But is there hope for our nation? I offer this to you. There is always hope if we will repent and humble ourselves before the Lord. The wicked city of Nineveh had but 40 days till the judgment of God came. The prophet went through the city crying, 40 days and destruction will come upon you. 40 days and you will be destroyed by the hand of God. But all the people of that city clothed themselves in sackcloth and ashes, got down on their knees, prayed for forgiveness, and repented of their sin. And God spared them. So there is always hope for America. But we must confess our sin. We must repent of the sin. Turn back to God if we're to be saved. God always sends his warning cry. He always sounds the alarm in the hope that we will turn back to him. When God's judgment comes upon you, it is not because he is angry with you. It is because he wants you to come back to him.
That's right.
So we must say in humbleness, you know, humbleness is the opposite of defiance. We must say in humbleness and in repentance, there is no hope in hewn stones, no hope in cedar trees. There is no hope in tall towers. There is no hope in America's spirit of defiance. There is no hope in our own strength, in our own confidence. There is hope in only Jesus Christ.
Right. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. That is part one of my message. And you might ask yourself, how could there possibly be more? Tune in next week. Same time, same place. And you will see that God's warning cry has been so loud and so strong, and it runs so much deeper than even the things I've shared with you this week. Let's stand and pray as we close. Heavenly Father, we thank you that you have sounded the warning cry. Lord, that you blew the shofar in New York Harbor even before the attacks took place. Lord, we're so thankful that your judgments come in stages. Lord, that you do not just simply wipe out a people all in one day, but you call out to them. You cry out to them, calling them back to you, Lord. Oh, Lord, it's my prayer that as this message goes out, as it seems to be all over the place right now, Lord, in your divine time and in your divine way, Lord. Lord, that the people of the United States, Christian or non-Christian, would hear and see the things that you are doing. Lord, and that you would draw us close to you in repentance and in humbleness of heart. For in you, our nation is sustained. And in you, our prosperity is found. In you, our confidence and strength is found, O God. Lord, I pray, draw us back to you. Draw me close to you. Never let me go. No one else will do.
no one else will do. 'Cause nothing else could take your place. Feel the warmth of your embrace.
Help me find the way.
Help us find the way. Bring us back to you.
You're all I want.